In the past, there's no doubt that supercharged engines were the go-to if you wanted to go fast on in a drag car. These days though, particularly in the pro mod ranks, the turbocharged engines have really shown their form. And one of the key players in the pro mod ranks is Proline from the US, building some of the stoutest turbocharged engines around. And we're here with Frank from Dandy Engines to talk a little bit more about these engines and what goes into developing them as well as keeping them reliable. So, Frank, for a start, the engine that we're actually talking about here is fitted to this amazing, immaculate XW Falcon. And can you just give us some insight? What sort of ETM mile an hour is this car currently running?
Well, the car's currently been 672 at 216 mile an hour.
Now, that's a long way away from the high fives that we see in Pro Mod, but this is not a Pro Mod car. It's a full chassis, basically a modified street car.
It's a factory body car. So this, the picture of the car was built on a production line, not intended for drag racing.
And the biggest thing that straight away is obvious is it doesn't have a lot of tyre in the rear end. So safe to say that you've got this Proline engine turned down a long way to get those 670s without overcoming the available traction.
Yeah, definitely. The fact that it's a leaf spring and a small tyre, it's got two things going against it. So we have to turn it right down and just try our best at power management.
All right, so let's get on to that engine, the Proline engine. Can you tell us a little bit about the specification of it, capacity, etc.?
Well, it's a billet-based block and cylinder head platform. Therefore, they can throw as much boost as you want at them, but in this case, we're limited to how much boost the car will take.
In ProMod stakes, though, as well, it's just worth talking about the fact that in ProMod and NHRA, there are turbocharged cars, supercharged cars, and nitrous cars running. So there's some rulings from NHRA to try and level the playing field between the three different engine styles. Can you tell us how that works?
Well, I mean, the turbos make that much power that they've got to try and cap the boost to try and equal the playing field. When they started out, in NHRA, I think the boost was up to like 50 odd pounds of boost for a turbo car. Now they're capped all the way down to like 32 pounds.
So as the turbos have sort of, the technology's improved and they're making more and more power for the same boost, that boost cap's come down?
Correct.
Okay, in terms of capacity of the engine, what are we looking at?
These are, an NHRA is like 526 cubic inch. I mean, we've stroked this one to 540 cubic inch with the guys at Proline.
So, one of the things that I'm interested to learn a little bit more about is the required maintenance on these engines, because it's easy for us to sit back and watch these cars running on YouTube with absolutely no consideration to what's required to make, you know, maybe 4,000+ horsepower. But of course, that requires, to keep them reliable, does require considerable maintenance. Yeah. So can you talk us through, if you're running at the NHRA Pro Mod level with them wound up as far as you can, what sort of regular maintenance is required from these engines?
They're actually a very strong base platform. Basically, they're always between rounds, they're checking valve springs, they're checking lash. And that helps the tuner work out if they're really leaning on it hard, and if it stretches a valve, they'll pick it up when they're checking the lash. So that requires a cylinder head to come off. But the head, these motors are built so well that you can remove a cylinder head without removing the intake manifold to do a quick turnaround.
So that's really the development that's come about from making these engines easier and quicker to work on over the years. Now, you just talked about stretching a valve, which sounds pretty extreme. So, you know, how often does this happen? What's the sort of life expectancy of a valve train components?
Well, we've already gotten close to like 80 or 90 runs from a set of valves. They say like the valve lifespan is like 70 runs, but we've been conservative. We don't have it right on the edge. We remove the spark plugs from like 1 to 2 runs, and we read the spark plugs to try and get an idea what's happening inside the motor.
That's a technique we've seen across generations. Obviously now moving away from constant flow fuel injection to the modern EFI systems gives us a lot more ability to see what's going on. So are you backing up the spark plug reading with what you're seeing in data as well after a pass?
Oh yeah, like you can have every form of sensors reading whatever you want, but nothing beats what a spark plug tells you.
In terms of the boost level and RPM that you're running this particular engine to, again, understanding that you're very much traction limited, what are you running there?
Well, like we said, the NHRA's run 32 pound and they're making roughly 3,300 horsepower. We're at 45 pound. And even in the top end, we'd like to put more, but the tyre just won't take it. I mean, we don't have dedicated radial tracks here in Australia, so we have to try and work with the track and the configuration of the car. So the most we will see is between 45, 46 pound.
And can you give us some idea of what power you think it's producing at that sort of boost level?
I know at 32 pound, you know, if they make around 3,500 horsepower at the back wheels. So at 45, I'm tipping we're going to be just under 4,000.
And you're still running the NHRA mandated turbo for the Pro Mod class?
We're actually running the Gen 1 version of those, which is a bit older. So they're definitely NHRA stamped turbos. They can make 50 pound if we wanted them to, but with this kind of car, we just can't apply it.
Now, in terms of, we talked about the valve train there. The other thing you mentioned there is just checking the lash. Obviously, you talk about the valve stretching and that will show up with an increase in the lash clearance. What sort of life expectancy do you see out of the valve springs as well? Because that's something we sort of see, particularly in the likes of Pro Stock. They tend to cycle through valve springs pretty quickly. Is that the same with these Pro Mod engines?
Definitely. If you're, you know, pushing the envelope and you're revving them to 9,000 plus, you're going to be on top of valve springs. With Steve's car, we don't run it to 9,000. We only run it to like 8,000. Yeah. And we barely even pull the rock covers off between rounds.
Well, last thing you really want at a meeting like this is to spend all your time working on the engine. So that makes sense. Getting down into the rotating assembly, I'm going to assume here you're running the sort of pretty standard drag racing alloy connecting rods. What sort of life do you see out of those? And for that matter, the rest of the rotating assembly, the pistons and the crankshaft?
If you were going to run the 50 pounder boost or plus, you have to change the rods every 30 runs. At 40, 45 pound like we are, we should be changing them every 80 passes. But in this case, we've actually gone past that point already. And it's only because we just don't have time between races and the season's kicked off. So we're just taking a bit of a gamble here. But, you know, it's already shown that it's gone way past that. But
that can, however, be an expensive gamble.
It can be. But look, these platforms, again, they're so good that if it does break a rod, the motors are easily repaired.
That's actually something I wanted to get onto, and obviously back in the older days with factory-based cast iron blocks, if you punched a rod through the side of the block, that was game over for the block. These billet CNC machined alloy blocks, however, actually can be recovered. Can you talk to us how that works?
Well, definitely. I mean, the aluminium is so good in the block, and the way that they are designed, it's not very hard to basically cut up what they call a window and weld in a piece wherever you've broken the piece of the block, and repair it and send it back on its way again.
Now, Proline, again, as I mentioned at the start, well known for their success over in the US. However, they are a US-based engine producer, and we're all the way over here in Australia. So the implications of having to send an engine back to Proline for a freshen up might be a little bit off-putting. So can these engines be serviced here in Australia?
Definitely. I mean, we've had a 10-year-long relationship with the guys at Proline, and we do a lot of their servicing back at our shop at Danny Engines. We've got a full machine shop. We just had a guy last week drop a valve in this, you know, which broke the valve off the stem of the valve, and it made a total mess. It wasn't hard for us to get onto the phone, order the parts, repair the cylinder head, and that guy's ready to run in the next couple of weeks.
I think that's really important, particularly if you are in a championship where you need to be running consistently. You can't be out of the championship for a month or 6 weeks while you're waiting for an engine to be sent to the US and back. So that makes a lot of sense. Look, Frank, it's been great to get some insight into what makes one of these cars go and go reliably. If people want to find out more about Dandy Engines, where can they go to?
Well, we're on YouTube and we're on obviously on the web. So, yeah. Shouldn't be too hard to find.
Perfect. Thanks for the chat there, Frank.
No worries. Thank you.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.